guys, Hilary here with Waterlogged. Today, we are gonna talk about basslets. All right, so today we are going to talk about basslets, and before we get too far into it, I wanna go ahead and let you know that rockwork is really important for these guys. If you are thinking of adding a basslet to your tank, or if you are thinking about getting one and don't have a tank, rockwork is super important. If you look at how they behave in the wild, they're spending a lot of time hanging out in and around rockwork. They like those little overhangs, they like to have little caves. And something else to note is that they're fairly territorial about their space. Once they have what is theirs, they will defend it and become very, very aggressive. Now, something else to note about these guys is that as they do spend a lot of time hanging kind of back in and around the rockwork is those lighting levels. So they're not gonna be hanging out in such bright lights as we might keep in our reef tanks. So we'll touch on that a little bit later, but something to be mindful of if you are thinking about getting a basslet. Now we're gonna break all of these guys down into three different categories. So first we're going to do our Leopropoma basslets, we're gonna talk about the Grammas, and then we have another category with a couple of miscellaneous genus of basslets. So we're gonna jump right in to the holy grail of fish in our Leopropoma category, and that is the candy basslet. Now you can see from its gorgeous colors why this is such a sought after fish. Now, if you are lucky enough to find them, beware, they have a pretty big price tag that's associated with them, so you might not want to spend that much, and if you don't, the Swissguard basslet is a great option. As you can see, they look very similar in color. Swissguard basslet's just not quite as bright as that candy basslet, but it is very similar in how it looks and its behavior, so that's one for you to consider. The last in our Leopropoma category is our peppermint basslet. And these guys are a good bit darker. They're not as bright and colorful as the first two. And something that I want you to be cautious of is all of these guys in this category that I've talked about so far, they might go after some of your small crustaceans and invertebrates that are in the tank. So you're gonna wanna make sure to keep them well fed. And we'll talk about that more as we get in the kitchen. Our next category of fish is going to be the Grammas. Now, if there is a fish that is in the basslets that I see on a regular basis in local aquarium stores, is going to be the Royal Gramma. With that beautiful purple and yellow, they are very sought after fish and they make great additions to large systems as well as smaller ones. Something to note with these guys, they are one of the first of the basslets that were able to be bred in captivity, so they are available. Sometimes you can find them as captive bred species. Now the next Gramma is the black cap basslet, similar in color except it's just that solid purple as opposed to the yellow. Now these guys spend in the wild, they're going to be spending their time a little bit deeper in the water column, so keep that in mind. They might not come out as frequently as the Royal Gramma would, so if you are looking for a Gramma and you want to see them more often, I would go with the Royal as opposed to the black cap basslet. Now, our last category is kind of a miscellaneous category. These two are in their own genus. The first one is the chalk basslet. Now, these guys, I feel like, are a bit of an underrated basslet. They're not as colorful as the other ones that we've talked about, but when it comes to their temperament, they're significantly more peaceful than all of the other ones on this list. And if you're going to successfully keep a basslet in a group of basslets, this is going to be your fish. Now something else, this is another one of those captive bred species, and as always, I like to remind people if you can purchase a captive bred fish to go for it, and there's several reasons for that. One, it's going to reduce the strain on the wild populations. Two, it's probably going to be a lot healthier, you probably won't have to worry about some of those wild parasites that come in on fish. And the third reason is because they're probably already going to be eating a lot of times in the labs that culture them, they're going to be feeding them commercially available foods, so why not go ahead and get a fish that you already know is eating without any issues. Last species is the yellow assessor, or sometimes they're called the golden assessor. This is another one of those captive bred species, and something that's really cool about this guy is if you do have that appropriate rock work and some of those overhangs, a lot of times you might see this guy hanging out upside down, just chilling there in the rockwork. So definitely keep that in mind. It's a cool behavior to watch. All right, that's all of the basslets that I have on this list today, but let's go ahead and go over some of the sizes and the tanks that they're gonna need. So that first category, the Leopropoma basslets, they are going to stay between 2.5 and 3 inches. And while you can put them in a larger system, I would recommend keeping them in, say, a nano reef. And the reason for this is because since they spend so much time in the rockwork, they might get lost in a larger system. So I would recommend a tank that's maybe 10 to 20 gallons. That way that you can fully observe them and they're not going to get lost like they might in a bigger tank. Now, all of the other basslets that are on this list will grow anywhere from 3 to 4 inches in size and are good in a 30-gallon tank. Now, if you're gonna keep more than one of these guys, you need to make sure you have a significantly larger tank. As I mentioned, they get territorial and very aggressive, so you wanna make sure they've got their space. Let's go discuss some of the nutritional requirements that your basslets will need to be successful and healthy. Basslets, as you might have guessed, are carnivores, which means they're going to be eating a lot of meaty foods. Now, I'm curious if you've ever kept a basslet in your tank. Let me know in the comments below what kind of food was its favorite to eat. Now, as usual, I'm going to break things down into several different categories. We're going to have our dry foods, we're going to have our DIY foods, we got our live and liquid foods, and our frozen foods. But before I get into that, I'm going to remind you that some of these basslets actually will go after invertebrates in your tank. So you're going to want to make sure that they're getting well fed to reduce the risk of them picking at some of those smaller shrimps and crabs. Now, today I'm just going to be talking about pellet foods. If you've got a community tank and you're using flakes, totally fine. But if you spend some time watching where these basslets hang out, they're going to be darting in and out of the rockwork and spending a lot of time in the middle of the water column. So that's kind of where you want to gear your food towards. So with that, let's start with our Reef Nutrition TDO Chroma Boost. These pellets are the perfect small size for their tiny little mouths, and they have a bunch of color enhancing properties that are going to help to bring out all of those reds in your fish. Another color-enhancing food that we have is the Nyos Wild Goji. This is another one that's gonna help to bring out those red pigments in your fish and just help them to pop and just look beautiful. Our next pellet food today is probably my favorite overall pellet food. This is the New Life Spectrum Probiotics. It's a great community food, and I love that it comes in a bunch of different sizes for whatever kind of fish that you have. And the last one I'm going to talk about today is the Cobalt Marine Pellets. This is a good overall food for carnivores, so it's a great one for you to consider. Something else is the pellets are relatively small, and when you put them in the tank, they do sink through the water column, so it's a great idea to feed those basslets. Moving on to our DIY foods. I don't have a ton of them today because these basslets aren't going to be picking at the rockwork necessarily like some of the other fish species that we've talked about, but I do love these foods when it comes to adding medications or vitamins and ensuring that they get it. So the first one is going to be the Dr. Tim's Aquatics Beneficial Fish Food. Again, I just love it because you can add all of those vitamins in. If you have to add medications, you can put it in. It gives you everything that you need in these little kits, so definitely something to consider. Now, if you want to make more of a dough that you can put on the rocks, or you can hand feed if they are trained to hand feed, consider the New Life Spectrum dough mix. You can also get the gel from them, so whatever is your preference. Moving on to our liquid and live foods, right? So I mentioned that these basslets are going to be eating a lot of small creatures in your tank, some of those invertebrates and maybe some shrimps, and why not take advantage of that and feed them some pods? They're probably going to be doing that if you have pods in your tank already. So if you do, I would recommend when you're cleaning your filtration to try and pick those pods out. Now, if you're not a big fan of that, it's kind of gross and messy, I know. We have some options for you. So the Algagen Tisby pods are one option that you have. You can get these on Marine Depot, and they come in a couple of different sizes for you. Next are the products by Reef Nutrition. I really like this. And the first one is the roe. So real ocean eggs. This is great. It has a lot of those good omegas that these fish need. So consider that as one of your options. Next from Reef Nutrition is going to be the Tigger pods. They're just one type of pod that they offer. If you don't like those, you can always switch it up and go with the Apex pods. All right, those are all of the live and liquid foods. Let's move on to our last category, frozen foods. You can always use something like the San Francisco Bay brand Reef Multipack. I've talked about these before. I love them because you can pop out individual portioned amounts of food and it's no mess involved. Now the last one today is brine shrimp. You can find brine shrimp by a bunch of different manufacturers. This is just the one that I happen to have, but it's another one of those foods that's small enough for them to eat and it has a lot of those color enhancing properties in it. So consider this if you are feeding basslets. Now let's go ahead and talk about some of the issues that your basslets might encounter. Basslets, like any other fish, encounter issues. However, they are a relatively hardy group of fish, which is why my list of issues that you might encounter with them is small. Now, that first issue, a lot of times when you are getting wild-caught fish that are coming in, they might have flukes. Not to say that captive bred fish don't have them, but something that you need to be watchful of, and a great reason for you to quarantine your fish before putting them in your display. Now, if you do notice this, there's a couple different things that you can do. First off, I recommend Blue Life USA's Safety Stop. It's a two-part dip that you put your fish in. It's got all of the instructions on the back, super easy. I would definitely recommend that in addition to quarantining. Another product that you can use is Quick Cure by Myrdal. This is a great one. It's going to remove any fluke infestations that they might have and help to get you on your way for a healthy fish. Now, one of the biggest issues that I've seen and heard about with basslets is jumping. They are jumpy little fish. If they can find a hole to get out of in your tank, they probably will, which is why it's important that you have a very secure fitting lid on the top. I've known people that have had a 75-gallon tank with two hang-on-the-back filters, and they've had, even though there was a lid on there, they've actually had basslets escape through the tiny little gaps. So be mindful of gaps in your tank that are not enclosed by a lid. If you don't have a lid on your tank, you can look for the manufacturer and ask them if they would recommend a lid, or Marine Depot has some DIY kits where you can make one yourself specifically for your tank. So consider those. All right, let's move on to enrichment. This is one of my favorite categories that I feel like gets left out when it comes to fish health and care. And it's a really easy way to just bring a little bit of joy to their life. All you gotta do is change up something in their environment and make it new and interesting for them. I've talked several times already about how important rockwork is for them, so if your tank doesn't have rockwork, go ahead and build a rockscape just for them. Make sure there's little overhangs or little caves that they can hide in. I wouldn't recommend rescaping your tank that often. Once they get their spot, they kinda like it, so leave that alone. But do make sure that you've got some well rockscaped areas of the tank for them. The next thing that you can do, and this is probably one of my favorite methods of enrichment, is feeding. Not only can you change up the different types of food that you use, but you can also put that food in front of a powerhead so that it disperses it and it gives them something fun to chase after. Now, speaking of chasing after food, you can give them a steady supply of live foods. You can use something like this pod habitat to encourage copepods to grow to a sizable population so they'll always have food to chase after. So that is one thing that you can do. Now, the last thing on this list today is their lighting. If you don't already have a programmable light, I would highly encourage you to consider getting one for your tank. And the reason for this is because they do spend so much time in the rockwork where it's a little bit darker. If you are able to slowly ramp up and slowly ramp down your lights throughout the day, you might have a better chance of seeing them come out, and it'll be a more hospitable environment for them that they will enjoy. Now, tank mates, right? We all want to have tank mates for our fish. So I'm gonna give you a couple of rules for these basslets. For the most part, a lot of them do well as the single basslet in their tank, but you can have more if you want to. You just need to make sure that you have a lot of space. So if you're gonna have more than one, give them a bunch of space. Like I mentioned before, they do get very territorial and aggressive if somebody comes into their space. But if you are gonna add more than one, go ahead and add them all at the same time. That way they can kind of go their separate ways and it'll reduce the aggression in the long term. Now, one cool thing about some species basslets is that they do reproduce in home aquariums. So if you are looking to have that happen in your tank, for example, Royal Grammas are a good one that a lot of people see this. You want to get one male and a couple of females. Now the male is easy to spot. They're gonna be a little bit larger than the females. So look for that. Make sure you add them all at the same time. Now, they are aggressive if you come to messing with their space and their territory, but otherwise they're fairly peaceful fish and they do well in community tanks. So don't put them in with more aggressive species like some of those triggers or pufferfish or even some of those aggressive angels. Keep them in good overall community tanks. But if you're not sure, you can always use the Marine Depot's fish compatibility chart. It's a great resource. And if that's not gonna have the answer that you're looking for, you can always ask some of the other hobbyists, send us a message. It's a great community to be a part of. All right, guys, that's all I've got for you today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.